So is the paper visible to you? Is it visible? Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
ಏನ್ ಕಾಣ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ?
ಮಾಡ್ಯೂಲ್ 4 ಶೇರ್ ಅಂತ ಕಾಣ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಸರ್.
ಕರೆಕ್ಟಾ? ಮಾಡ್ಯೂಲ್ 4. ಸೊ ಮಾಡ್ಯೂಲ್ 3, ಎ ಲಿಟಲ್ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಲೆಫ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಯುವರ್ ಮಾಡ್ಯೂಲ್ 3. ವಿ ವಿಲ್ ಕವರ್ ದಟ್ ಪೋರ್ಷನ್ ಲೇಟರ್ ಆನ್. ಸೊ ವಿ ವಿಲ್ ಫಿನಿಶ್ ವಿತ್ ದಿಸ್ ಶಿಯರ್, ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಯುವರ್ ಫೋರ್ತ್ ಮಾಡ್ಯೂಲ್. ಅಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ವಿ ವಿಲ್ ಕಮ್ ಬ್ಯಾಕ್ ಟು ಯುವರ್ ಥರ್ಡ್ ಮಾಡ್ಯೂಲ್, ವೇರ್ ಇನ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಲೆಫ್ಟ್ ವಿತ್ ಯುವರ್ ಪ್ರಿಲಿಮಿನರಿ ಡಿಸೈನ್. ಓಕೆ, ಪ್ರಿಲಿಮಿನರಿ ಡಿಸೈನ್ ಆಫ್ ಮೆಂಬರ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಫ್ಲೆಕ್ಸರ್, ದಟ್ ವಿ ವಿಲ್ ಕವರ್ ಲೇಟರ್ ಆನ್. ಸೊ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಯು ಟೆಲ್ ಮೀ ವೇರಿಯಸ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ದಟ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟ್ ಇನ್ ಅ ಮೆಂಬರ್? ವೇರಿಯಸ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ದಟ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟ್ ಇನ್ ಅ ಮೆಂಬರ್, ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಡೌನ್ ಆಸ್ ಯು ಸೇ. ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಯು ಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ವೇರಿಯಸ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ದಟ್ ಆರ್ ಇನ್ ಅ ಮೆಂಬರ್? ಒನ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ರಿಟನ್ ಆಲ್ರೆಡಿ, ದಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಶಿಯರ್. ಎನಿ ಅದರ್ ಮೆಂಬರ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ವಿಚ್ ಯು ರಿಕಾಲ್ ದಟ್ ಆರ್ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಇನ್ ಎನಿ ಬೀಮ್ ಆರ್ ಎನಿ ಕಾಲಮ್? ಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡೋಣ ಬಿಡಿ. ಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ವಿ ವಿಲ್ ಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ವೇರಿಯಸ್ ವಿ ವಿಲ್ ಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ವೇರಿಯಸ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ದಟ್ ಎಕ್ಸಿಸ್ಟ್ ಇನ್ ಅ ಮೆಂಬರ್, ಎನಿ ಸ್ಟ್ರಕ್ಚರಲ್ ಮೆಂಬರ್. ಲೆಟ್ ಮೀ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಲಿಸ್ಟ್ ಡೌನ್. ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಟೆಲ್ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಟೆನ್ಸೈಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್. ಸೆಕೆಂಡ್, ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಯು ಟೆಲ್ ಮೀ ಟೆನ್ಸೈಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್, ಎನಿ ಅದರ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್?
ಕಂಪ್ರೆಷನ್.
ಕಂಪ್ರೆಷನ್, ಓಕೆ, ಕಂಪ್ರೆಷನ್. ಓಕೆ, ಸೊ ದೀಸ್ ಟೆನ್ಸೈಲ್ ಕಂಪ್ರೆಷನ್ ಆರ್ ದೀಸ್ ಟು ಮೇ ಬಿ ಆಕ್ಸಿಯಲ್ ಫೋರ್ಸಸ್ ಆರ್ ಇಟ್ ಮೇ ಬಿ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ವರ್ಸ್. ಓಕೆ, ಸೊ ಥರ್ಡ್ ಈಸ್ ವಾಟ್? ಶಿಯರ್. ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್, ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್, ಎನಿ ಅದರ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್? ಎನಿ ಅದರ್ ಫೋರ್ಸ್ ಅದರ್ ದೆನ್ ದೀಸ್ ತ್ರೀ? ಟಾರ್ಷನ್ ಬರುತ್ತೆ, ಟಾರ್ಷನ್. ಕರೆಕ್ಟ್,
ಎಸ್ ಸರ್.
ಟಾರ್ಷನ್, ಟಾರ್ಷನ್. ದೆನ್ ದೇರ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಕಾಂಬಿನೇಷನ್ ಟಾರ್ಷನ್ ಸ್ಪೆಲ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ರಿಪಾರ್ಟ್. ಟಾರ್ಷನ್ ಇಸ್ ಟಾರ್ಷನ್, ಕರೆಕ್ಟ್? ಇಲ್ಲ. ದೆನ್ ಎನಿ ಅದರ್? ಓಕೆ, ನಾವ್ ವಿ ವಿಲ್ ದೇರ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಕಾಂಬಿನೇಷನ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದೀಸ್. ಓಕೆ, ದೇರ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಬಿ ಕಾಂಬಿನೇಷನ್ಸ್. ದೇರ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಬಿ ಶಿಯರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಟಾರ್ಷನ್ ಕಾಂಬಿನೇಷನ್, ದೆನ್ ಫ್ಲೆಕ್ಸರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅದರ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್. ಆಕ್ಸಿಯಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಫ್ಲೆಕ್ಸರ್ ಕಾಂಬಿನೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಆಕ್ಸಿಯಲ್. ಓಕೆ, ಆಕ್ಸಿಯಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಶಿಯರ್ ಇಟ್ ಗಿವ್ಸ್ ಯು ಫ್ಲೆಕ್ಸರ್. ಓಕೆ, ಫ್ಲೆಕ್ಸರ್. ದೆನ್ ಕಮಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್ಸಸ್, ಕಮಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್ಸಸ್. ಸೊ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಯು ನೇಮ್ ಫ್ಯೂ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್ಸಸ್, ಟೈಪ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್ಸಸ್? ಟೈಪ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್ಸಸ್ ನೇಮ್ ಮಾಡ್ರಿ, ಪಟಪಟ ನೋಡೋಣ. ಸ್ಕ್ರೀನ್ ನಾಟ್ ವಿಸಿಬಲ್ ಅ? ಇಸ್ ಇಟ್ ನಾಟ್ ವಿಸಿಬಲ್? ಅದರ್ಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಲೆಟ್ ಮೀ ನೋ ಇಫ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ವಿಸಿಬಲ್ ಆರ್ ನಾಟ್. ಈ ಸ್ಕ್ರೀನ್ ವಿಸಿಬಲ್ ಟು ಎವ್ರಿ ಒನ್? ಇಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಕ್ಲಿಯರ್?
ಎಸ್ ಸರ್, ಕಾಣ್ತಾ ಇದೆ ಸರ್.
ಕಾಣ್ತಾ ಇದೆ? ನೋ ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್. ಆರ್ ಶುಡ್ ಐ ರೈಟ್ ಯೂಸಿಂಗ್ ಸ್ಕೆಚ್ ಪೆನ್ಸ್? ಓಕೆ, ಒನ್ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ರೈಟ್ ನಾರ್ಮಲ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್. ನಾರ್ಮಲ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್, ಎನಿ ಅದರ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್ ದಟ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಆಫ್? ನಾರ್ಮಲ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್. ದೆನ್
ಬೆಂಡಿಂಗ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್ ಸರ್.
ಬೆಂಡಿಂಗ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್, ವೆರಿ ಗುಡ್. ದೆನ್ ವಾಟ್ ಈಸ್ ದ ಮಾಡ್ಯೂಲ್ ನೇಮ್ ಓವರ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ದಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ರಿಟನ್?
ಶಿಯರ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್.
ಕರೆಕ್ಟ್,
ಯಸ್ ಸರ್.
ಶಿಯರ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್ ಅಲ್ಲ, ಶಿಯರ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್. This bending stress is nothing but flexural stress. Okay. So normal stress, how do you represent? What is the symbol that we use to represent normal stress, bending stress and shear stress? Symbol. Enripa symbol. No idea. Sigma ripa, sigma for normal stress, correct? Bending stress we usually in F, right? We write F, or you can write also as sigma. Then this is tau, correct? Tau ala, tau for shear stress. Now what is stress? Can you tell me what is stress? Stress, suppose this is a cross sectional area, and there is some force acting on this cross-sectional area. And this is the longitudinal view. There is this force acting, F, on this surface, on this surface. That is here, I have shown in cross-section, this surface. Suppose this area of this surface is capital A. Now what is stress? Force by area, correct? Which force? This force divided by this cross-sectional area. Now this force is acting normal to this plane, right? It is normal, it is 90 degrees to this particular plane. Hence it is nothing but normal stress. Okay, now shear stress, where will shear stress act? It will act along the plane, okay? It will not act perpendicular to the plane. It is acting normal to the plane. It is acting normal to the plane, okay? It is not acting normal, it is acting along the plane. You can see this is the force F which is acting on this surface. So this stress is nothing but tau, which is F by this particular area, top surface, okay? Top surface area. That is, this is what average we have considered, average. Okay, tau average we have considered. But usually this particular cross-sectional area, it is, this force is not equally distributed as in shear stress, as in normal stress. You have to consider a different formula. Do you remember the formula for calculating this stress? Shear stress, it is V A Y bar by I B. Okay, so this is the formula which we have to use to calculate your shear stress. Okay, so what is V? V is shear force. Then A is area of area. I will show you this particular area which we are concerned with. Okay, area, it is the area in cross section. Then Y bar is the distance of the CG of this area. CG of this area from your neutral axis. Distance of the CG of this particular area from the neutral axis. Then what is I? I is nothing but moment of inertia, we know, no problem. What is B? B is breadth of the particular cross section. Now sometimes this particular A into Y will be given as S. Okay, first moment of inertia, what we call as first moment of inertia. Okay, first moment of inertia is A into Y. Okay, now let me show a cross section to you. So this is the cross section of a beam which I have considered. Okay, this is the cross section. Now this is the neutral axis. Okay, so the force, shear force acting on this particular plane is V, shear force. Now this is my point of interest. Suppose this point of interest is at neutral axis, my point of a plane, the plane of interest, okay, not point. The plane of my interest is at the neutral axis itself. Okay, so the area will be the entire thing. This will be my area, which I am writing over here as A. Area will be what? This B into this particular distance, which is what? Half of the total depth. This is depth D. This is what? D by 2. So area is what? Area is B into D by area when my plane of interest is at neutral axis. Okay, now what is Y bar? Now let me show you what is Y bar. Okay, so the CG of this particular area is here. You can see I have drawn a dot. This is the CG of this particular area. Now the distance of this particular CG from my neutral axis is what is Y bar. Okay, this is Y bar. So what is Y bar length? Can you tell me Y bar is equals to what in terms of D by 2? In terms of depth, it will be D by 4, correct? It will be D by 4. Have you understood this particular part? How you
yes,
calculate
sir.
V and Y? Okay, you have. I hope you have learned this in your previous semester. Then we are done with all this. So I hope all the terms in this equation are clear. Now let me show you one more scenario wherein we have this particular same cross section. We have same cross section. This is your neutral axis. Then this is my plane of interest. Okay, this is my plane of interest. Now, the area which you have to consider is from the top fiber to this particular area, area of this interest. Okay, you have to consider from the top fiber to this particular area of, or this plane of interest. Okay, so this area will be what now? Area will be equal to B into this particular depth, which we will call as, let's say, small d, area into b into small d. Okay, we can calculate this based on calculation. We can calculate this depth. We will be knowing this particular distance of this particular interested plane from your neutral axis. So you can minus that, you will get your small d. Okay, now I have told you what is y bar. Y bar is the CG of this particular area from the neutral axis, distance of this particular CG from the neutral axis. Okay. Now this is when you have your plane of interest in the above the neutral axis, but when you have this particular plane of interest below your neutral axis, then you have to consider this particular area. Okay, area you have to consider, where, which area? From the bottom fiber to the plane of interest, you have to consider this area, and this will be the CG of this particular area, and this will be y bar. Okay, so depending upon whether your plane of interest is in the upper portion or on the below portion, you can calculate area and y bar. Okay, but usually when you are dealing in this module, we are dealing with this particular case. Okay, this particular case we are dealing with, wherein our plane of interest is at the neutral axis itself. Okay, so your y will be d by 4 and your a will be b into d by 2. Now what we will do, we will substitute these two in this particular equation. We will substitute both of these in this equation. We will also substitute I, we will substitute b, all these values we will substitute, and we will try to simplify this particular equation. Okay, now can anyone tell me what is the formula for tau? General formula, tau is equals to what? By what? Divided by? Divided by what? Divided by? You don't recall, now only I have told you it is IB, okay, IB. Okay, so we are considering which case? We are considering that our plane of interest is at the neutral axis itself. So this is our area, this is B, this is D by 2. Okay, this area is D by 2, so area A will be B into D by 2, and Y bar will be equal to what? D by 2. Okay. What is moment of inertia I? I is equals to b d cube by 12. Okay, wherein d, this is d and this is b. Okay, now we will substitute all of this in your tau equation. Tau is equals to v as it is. Area is what? B into d by 2 into y bar is what? D by 4 divided by I is what? B d cube by 12 into b. So substitute, we are simplifying this particular equation. So b and this b will cancel, this d will cancel, and this particular power 3 will cancel off. So what we will be left out in the end will be, let me write down. So tau is equals to 1.5 times v by bd. This is what the equation is when we are dealing with the plane of interest at the neutral axis. So this is an important equation which you will be requiring for solving your numericals. Okay, so is this simplification clear? Arthaitre edo?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what is this V by BD? Okay, let me show you what is this V by BD. This is your cross section, correct? Cross section. V is the force that is acting, and B into D is what? Your total cross section, right? B into D is total cross section. So it is nothing but force by area, correct? Force by area. It is nothing but force by area. So
yes,
what
sir.
Is this is what? This is tau average. Or this is tau. This is tau average, 1.5. This is tau average. V by A, this is nothing but tau average. Okay. So what is tau average? Tau average is nothing but A by force by area. Force by area meaning here we are dealing with shear force, and it will be force V, and area is what? B into D. So this is known as tau average. So we can write 1.5 tau average will give me shear force. Okay, shear force in a rectangular section. Rectangular section when the neutral, when the area of interest is at neutral axis. Okay, so this is your derivation which we will be requiring, and the equation which we will be using to solve your numericals. Okay, so this is very important. Next, so after this is done, let me show you how the stress distribution is there. Stress distribution is there in your shear force, okay, in your cross section. So this is your cross section, typical cross section of a rectangular beam. Okay, this is my neutral axis. Now, can you tell me how the bending stress will vary, which you have studied, right? Bending stress in the first module, we were drawing the stress distribution diagram, right? How was the distribution in bending? And then I will draw for shear. Okay, in bending, it was in this format. I hope you recall. So it will be zero at your neutral axis. Your bending will be zero at neutral axis. So this is your stress distribution diagram for bending. Okay, this is for bending. Now, for shear, it will be in this format. It will increase at the center, at the midspan, it will be maximum, and at the top and bottom fiber, it will be zero. Okay, so it is opposite. You can see it is your bending stress is maximum at your flange section, at your top and bottom fiber, it is maximum, but in shear, it is zero. Okay, but and also it is opposite at the neutral axis. You can see at neutral axis, the bending stress is zero at neutral axis, but it is maximum in shear. Okay, so what this significant, what is the significance of this is, you can tell that bending, okay, bending is carried by the flange, okay, and the shear is carried by the mid portion. Okay, so because of this, this particular I section which we developed, right, I section, it is a very interesting section. Let me draw and show you in an I section. In an I section, how is the I section? We have two flanges, right, two flange and a web section. So your bending, okay, bending is carried by your flange. Bending, as you can see in the bending stress, it is maximum at the flange, right? So bending is carried by the flanges, and this web portion will carry your shear. Okay, so this is not the stress distribution diagram for I section. It is a general diagram which I have drawn. So actually the stress, shear stress distribution will be in this format. Let me draw. So it will come like this up to your level of flange. Then it will increase sudden, and then it will have an average stress up till here. And again, it will be symmetric. Okay, so this is the stress shear stress distribution diagram for your I section. This is general. This is bending stress distribution diagram for I section. So you can see that the flanges will carry your bending stresses, and your web section, you can see it will carry maximum of your what? Shear stresses. So this I section is very efficient in carrying your stresses, that is your bending stress and your shear stress. Okay, so we have covered a few basic things regarding shear and regarding your bending. Now, a few assumptions that we are going to take when we are going to calculate your shear stresses. The first assumption that we do is shear is constant across your cross section. Shear is constant across your cross section. Now, let me tell you what we mean by that. So, suppose this is your cross section which we are considering. Then I have told you how the cross section varies. So, how the shear stress varies? It varies in a parabolic form, like this. It varies. Now it is constant across your cross section, meaning if I draw this in 3D, it will be like this. Stress distribution will be in this format. Okay, it will be constant everywhere. Okay, I hope you have understood. So it is your stress is constant across your cross section. This is the value which is constant throughout your cross section. This throughout your cross section, it is constant in this direction. It is constant. It is not varying. It is not varying like this. Let me show you. So this is your cross section stress, shear stress. It is constant. It is not varying, meaning it is not changing. At this particular section, if I draw you at this particular section, it is this. Okay, this value I will draw like this. this particular value I've drawn. It is constant. Okay, it is constant like this. It is not varying like this. It is not varying. It is constant by the breadth of your section. This is one more assumption, but it is only holding true when your B is small, when the thickness of your section is small. But when your thickness of your section, right, this B is very large, right? If this B is very large, this will not hold true. Okay, it will not hold true. It will vary across your B also. It will not only vary across your depth. Your stresses will also vary across B. Okay, so this is one assumption. Second assumption, what we do is that your shear stress, okay, shear stress acts in y direction. That is, it acts only in this direction. Your shear forces, which are there, right? If you have a force which is acting like this, external force, this is your stresses which are there, or the forces which are there, and they act only in one direction. This is one more assumption which we consider. Okay, but this is true only when you have this kind of cross section. But when you have a circular cross section, let me show you. When we have a circular type of cross section, the shear stress, right? This is your circular cross section. The shear force will be acting like this. It will be acting circumferentially. This is how your force flows throughout your cross section. It is not always in y direction. But this is true. In which case? This is true when you are considering at neutral axis. At neutral axis, all these forces are in which direction? Are in y direction. Okay, it is only holding true. The second assumption holds true only when you are considering at neutral axis. So these are two assumptions which we take into considerations. Now, what do you mean by a pure shear? Okay, pure shear state. Pure shear state. So consider. Okay, let us consider a beam. Okay, let us consider a beam. This is the cross section of our beam, and we have a longitudinal section like this. Longitudinal section. Now we have considered a small portion of this beam. Now I will enlarge this particular beam. Okay, this particular element I have shown an enlarged view over here. Enlarged view. This is not the cross section. This is what? This is the enlarged view of this particular small element which I have considered. Okay, when you have only pure shear state, it means only you have shear forces is in these two directions. Okay, shear forces in these two directions. This is shear force tau. Okay, tau. So this is called as pure shear state, wherein we do not have any axial forces. We do not have any axial forces like this. No normal forces are present. Only shear forces are present. Tau is present. These forces are zero. Okay. So this is regarding what? This is regarding your pure shear state. Now let me explain to you what we mean by this equilibrium state. Equilibrium state. I hope you are following. Are you there? Are you there with me still? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So similarly, what I'll do, I will consider a small element. Okay, a very small element I have considered. Okay. So this small element has a force acting on it, an external force F. Okay. So in shear, it will have some force like this acting. Okay, a counter force it will generate in itself. Now we know that this particular element is in equilibrium, right? The beam is not moving, it is in static state, right? It is in equilibrium state. So to balance this internal force, we have to generate one more force, right, in the opposite direction, correct? To balance this particular force, one more force we have generated, which is in opposite direction. Now we also know that for rotational equilibrium, because this particular element is not rotating, right? Because we can see that this is nothing but a couple. Right, it is a couple force, it is a couple. So it what couples tend to do, it will tend to rotate your element, right? But this element is not rotating. We know it is in static, it is in equilibrium position. So to counteract this particular couple which is generated, we need to develop one more opposite couple, right? So this is how we have developed our pure shear state, right? Pure shear state, this is tau. All these forces are nothing but tau. Okay, so this is what pure shear state, pure shear, wherein we do not have any normal forces acting on our element. Okay. So this is regarding what? This is regarding pure shear. Next. Now let us consider that a 2D stress element. I will draw an enlarged view of this particular same thing. I will draw an enlarged view. Same element I have drawn in a larger scale. Okay, I will draw the shear stresses. This is tau. Okay, remember the sign convention that we have to use. Okay, the direction we have to use, that is upper right side, upper direction. Okay, right side, upper direction. Okay, do not draw this as upper direction. Draw at the right side upper, and all the other things you can follow. So this is what tau. We will consider this as x1. Okay, these and these both are equal. These are also tau x1. Same thing. Now we have some normal forces acting on our beam. They may be pre-stressing forces, or they may be generated due to external forces. Sigma x we will consider. Similarly, in the y direction, we will consider this as sigma y. Okay, so these in pink color are normal stresses, and in the red color, which I have shown, are shear stresses. Okay, shear stresses. This is what? This is 2D stress element. Okay, it is a 2D thing. In a 3D, it will be like a cube. Okay, we will not go get into 3D. We are only considering a single plane. Okay, 2D stress element. Now the thing is, we can determine this particular sigma x, sigma y. We know what is the value, that is the stress value which is acting on the plane, right? But we, sometimes what happens is, sometimes when we want to join two elements, suppose this is one element, at a certain angle you have cut this particular element like this, you have cut this element, and you want to join to this element with one more element. This is one more element, so it is to be welded at this particular point, right? This is a weld which we are doing. So this particular state is at perpendicular direction to the normal axis, but sometimes we need to calculate stresses at a certain angle, right? At a certain angle which we are interested in. So what we can do, we can take a stress element in this particular angle itself. This particular angle itself we will consider our stress element. So what I'll do, this particular element I will rotate. I will rotate by some angle. Okay, I will rotate by some angle theta p. Okay, I will angle, I will rotate this particular in this direction. So I will draw the same, but this particular thing at a required angle. Okay, so this is rotated at an angle. This is your horizontal. This is my vertical. This is my base, which I have rotated at an angle theta p. Theta p. Now the same forces are acting. Same forces will be acting here. Tau x. This is tau x. Then we have normal forces, sigma x. This is sigma y. This is also sigma y. Okay, we can keep on rotating up till we reach our desired plane. Okay, we can keep on rotating, and we can find out various values of sigma and tau. Okay, now suppose this is theta value, theta p value, and we have sigma value, and we have tau value. Now we start with zero angle. We start with zero angle. We find out sigma and tau. Okay, we find out sigma and tau. Now we go on rotating our element. We go on rotating our element in this format. We will rotate, and in some angle, say suppose we have some angle, at that particular angle we find that sigma is maximum. And when sigma is maximum, you find out that tau is zero. Tau is zero. Okay, theta p, we start with zero, we find out sigma, and we find out tau. Okay, so we go on rotating our element, and we find at a certain angle, we find that our sigma is maximum and tau is zero. Okay, again we go on continue to rotating it, and another certain value we have, a certain degree of rotation, we find out that our sigma is minimum and your tau is zero. Tau is zero at a certain angle. So what this represents is, when you have zero shear stresses and you have maximum normal stress and minimum normal stress, you will observe that at maximum and minimum, at a certain angle, you will find that shear stresses are zero. Okay, so what we will do is, we will call this particular thing wherein we have found out that it is maximum, we will name it as sigma 1, and this minimum value we will call it as sigma 2. So wherever your maximum value and minimum value are occurring, there your shear stresses will be zero. Compulsory, this condition will be there. And these particular sigma 1 and sigma 2 we will call as principal stresses. Sigma 1 and sigma 2 are called as what? principal stresses, where your sigma are maximum and your shear stresses are zero. These are principal stresses, sigma 1 and sigma 2. So we have a particular formula to calculate sigma 1 and sigma 2. Now, do you recall this particular formula which we have derived previously? We use this particular principal stresses in our saw, in our structural analysis, in your SOM, I think you have studied, also in geotechnical engineering, you have studied this, right? So let me write down the formula for the sigma 1 and sigma 2. So sigma 1 is equals to sigma x plus sigma y by 2 plus or minus square root of sigma x minus sigma y by 2 the whole square plus tau xy square. Okay, so this is for sigma 1 and also for sigma 2. If you use plus sign, it will give you maximum value, that is sigma 1. And if you use minus sign here, it will give you the lowest value, that is your sigma minimum or sigma 2. So this is how you can calculate your sigma 1 and sigma 2, which are nothing but your principal stresses. Now, for the angle, for the angle of rotation, for which angle you get your maximum this value, right, sigma 1 and sigma 2, you can find out by this particular formula, which is 2 tau xy by sigma x minus sigma 1. So these two are very important, which we will be requiring for solving your numericals. Okay, sigma 1 and sigma 2, which are your principal stresses, and tan 2 theta p is from this particular formula, we can find out the angle. Okay, theta p we can find out. Okay, we will be knowing tau xy, sigma x, sigma y we will be knowing. We can substitute, we can calculate theta p. Okay, and one more important thing is, I forgot to mention. Okay, so here, this particular angle, say some, you get angle of 100 degrees. At 100 degrees, you find out that it is maximum. And you find that at 190 degrees, this is minimum. Okay, this is minimum. So the difference between these two, okay, we'll see, difference between these two will always be 90 degrees. Okay, so the angular difference between sigma 1 and sigma 2 is 90 degrees. Okay, meaning if this is maximum, then here will be your minimum. At this phase, if it is maximum, at this phase, it will be minimum. Okay, it will be minimum. This phase, if it is maximum, this phase, it will be minimum, right, at 90 degrees. So this is regarding your details for what we will be requiring for solving, right? Principal stresses we will be requiring to find out in your shear. Okay, so these are a few things which we have discussed. I hope you have followed. So if you didn't follow any of the part, please let me know. I'll solve again, or I'll derive this particular formula again if you have not understood. Arthaitri do?
Yes, sir.
Solpa, solpa, sir.
Arthaitri and bouncer utri. And solve solve arthaitri. And clear again arthaitri alla. Sandesh?
Yes, sir. Understood, sir.
Arthaitri. ಇದು ವೆರಿ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಫಾರ್ಮುಲಾ ಅಲ್ಲ ಇದು ದಿಸ್ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಫಾರ್ಮುಲಾ
ಎಸ್ ಸರ್ ಸಾಮ್ಸ್
ಸಾಮ್ ರೈಟ್ ಸಾಮ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇನ್ ಜಿಯೋಟೆಕ್ನಿಕಲ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ರಿಕ್ವೈರಿಂಗ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಓಕೆ ಸೊ ರಿಮೆಂಬರ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪರ್ಟಿಕ್ಯುಲರ್ ಫಾರ್ಮುಲಾ ಇಸ್ ಫಾರ್ ದಿಸ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್ ಡಯಾಗ್ರಾಮ್ ಓಕೆ 2D ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್ ಎಲಿಮೆಂಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೆಸ್ ಎಲಿಮೆಂಟ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ರಿಮೆಂಬರ್ ಓಕೆ ಅಂಡ್ ದ ಆಂಗಲ್ ಹೌ ದ ಆಂಗಲ್ ಇಸ್ ಓವರ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಸಿ ಆಂಗಲ್ ಇಸ್ ಓವರ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ಥೀಟಾ ಪಿ ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಮೆಜರ್ಡ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದ ಹಾರಿಜಾಂಟಲ್ ಓಕೆ ಥೀಟಾ ಪಿ Okay, so this is how you can rotate and you can find out the stress element at various angles, right? At various angles you can calculate sigma and tau you can find out. So I have told you where your shear stress is zero, that particular plane we call those particular planes as principal stresses, sigma 1 and sigma 2, or principal planes we call as principal planes.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, in SOM and all, the angle is measured from a vertical face, sir.
Right. It is measured from vertical. So here what we are doing, we are measuring from horizontal, this particular face. From this particular face, we are measuring, it is theta p. Okay. I have also learned in the SOM, it is from vertical, right? It is from vertical, right? If you are measuring, you have taken this particular plane, then what we do, we take this as theta p, right?
Yes, sir.
Correct. So I think Correct. It will give the same answer, because in the textbook what they have followed is, they have followed this particular convention. that this particular convention they have followed, and they have arrived at the same equation. Okay, so
yes,
I think that they both these cases will give us the same answer.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this particular theta, I think we'll not be dealing with theta in this particular chapter. Okay, theta will not be dealing with. The important thing that we have to note down is this particular principal stresses, sigma 1 and sigma 2. Okay, so remember this particular formula. In some cases, what happens is instead of sigma, okay, instead of sigma, they will use F. Instead of sigma, they will use F, right? Sigma X will become Fx and sigma Y will become F of Y. Okay, so this convention may be used in some cases. Remember, it is the same thing. Okay, so any other thing regarding shear, if you want to know, let me know, I will explain. Shear. Regarding shear, I hope it is clear. Main one more formula that you have to remember is tau is equals to what? VA Y bar by IB. Correct? So these things you have to remember. These three things you have to remember. Okay. So we have discussed regarding rectangular shear stress distribution, how it is in rectangular section, how the shear stress distribution acts in a I section, right? Flange section, I have shown you, right? And then what are the two assumptions that we make, right? The shear stress is constant across the cross section, I have told you, that is one assumption. And one more assumption is that stress acts in y direction. But these two cases are not true for all the cases, right? It varies depending upon the case. Also, we have discussed what 2D stress element we have discussed, and we have arrived at this particular equation, right? Principal stress equation we have arrived, and we have seen the shear stress calculation, how we have to do using this particular formula. So these basic things we will be requiring for analysis of your members in shear, So we have to discuss a few more things. I will start the presentation and we will discuss in the other mode. Idella artha aitri, no problem here. Any concept you didn't understand, let me know. So we have to study a few concepts regarding shear, right? Types of shear failures, types of cracks, and constituents of your shear diagram. All those things we will study. Okay, is the screen visible? What does the screen say, which you are seeing? What is the title of the screen, title of the slide?
Types of cracks.
Types of cracks. Okay. So we will understand first what are the types of cracks that are there, and then we will look into modes of failure. Okay, modes of failure we have to understand. So what are the types of cracks you can see on your screen? What are the three main types of cracks?
Flexural cracks, web shear, and flexural shear.
Correct. So there are the types of cracks. Okay, types of cracks depend on what? They depend on span to depth ratio. Span to depth ratio meaning what? L by D. So depending upon this ratio, your types of cracks, okay, types and formation of your crack will vary. Okay, also on the beam type, okay, also on the type of beam and the loading which it is carrying. Okay, now these particular things, okay, these are for which? These are for simply supported beam, okay, simply supported beam under uniformly distributed load. Okay, these three cracks are common in this beam, simply supported beam under uniformly distributed load. Okay, flexure cracks, web shear cracks, and flexure shear cracks combination. Okay, so the first type of crack, flexure shear crack. So flexure shear crack, it occurs where? At the bottom, near the mid span. Okay, remember, it occurs at the bottom of your beam near the mid span, and it propagates in upward direction. Okay, the cracks propagate in upward direction. You can see this is a simply supported beam having a UDL. Okay, it is having a UDL. So where the cracks start? At the mid span. Okay, at the mid span, at the bottom. And they propagate towards your beam. Okay, inside your beam, they propagate upward direction. So this is regarding your flexure crack. Okay, flexure crack, they occur in tension zone. Tension zone, right? And where your tension zone is maximum, tension zone, your beam bends in this particular format, right? Flexure, in flexure, your beam bends, right? We have studied in flexure. Your beam will bend in this particular format. So this is your tension zone, and the tension will be maximum in this particular portion. So there your cracks start to occur, and they will propagate in your upward direction in this format. So this is regarding your flexure crack. Now moving on to second thing, web shear cracks. Web is where in the central portion. Web is the central portion, except your flange here, right? Your top and your bottom flange, if you leave out, then you will be left out with this web portion. Now web shear cracks. These cracks form near the neutral axis, okay, close to the supports. Where your web shear cracks occur, they occur at your support, okay. Okay, so these are not your web shear cracks. These are your flexure cracks. Okay, so these are your flexure cracks. At your support, in this portion, you can see there are cracks which are occurring in diagonal direction, right? They are diagonal and they are occurring near the neutral axis. Okay, near the neutral axis, that is in the central portion in your web. Okay, and they are in diagonal format. Diagonal format, they are being generated. So these are your web shear cracks. These are your flexure cracks, right, at the midspan, starting from the bottom, propagating upwards. Okay. So these are web shear cracks, these are flexure cracks. Next, flexure shear cracks occur where? In between, okay, in between. This is your flexure shear crack. Flexure plus shear, this is due to flexure, this is due to shear, and this is due to combination, flexure and shear. Okay, so you can see here, all the cracks are shown in the single figure. You can see flexure cracks occur in this portion. In the midspan, you can see they are starting from the bottom, right? Soffit of your beam propagating upwards. So this is your flexure cracks. Next, near the support, you can see in the midspan, right? I add the neutral axis, you can see in diagonal format, you can see web shear cracks are occurring. And both the supports, these cracks occur. Okay, in between these two, you can see flexure shear cracks in between. Okay, they start from bottom and they are also propagating upwards. Okay, usually in diagonal format, right? This is diagonal and slowly they become straight, right? As they approach flexure shear cracks, they start to become straight. Okay, they start diagonally, but as they start moving towards the center, they become straight. Okay, so these are the various types of cracks. Okay, the main cracks which occur in your simply supported beam, okay, simply supported beam in a which is loaded in a by a UDL, loaded by UDL, a simply supported beam. Okay, so one more thing is that this beam is having a very long span. So these cracks usually occur in this type of beam, wherein you have a simply supported beam supported by a loaded by a UDL and having long span. Okay, so the types which we have learned is flexure cracks, web shear cracks, and flexure shear cracks. So this is regarding types of cracks. Now, once we have learned the types of cracks, we can learn what are the various modes of failures. Okay, modes of failure. Okay. For beams with low span to depth ratio, low span to depth ratio, or inadequate shear reinforcement, right? Low span to depth ratio, or wherein we do not provide adequate number of shear reinforcement. This kind of shear failures we can see. All these are types of shear failures. When we do not provide adequate shear reinforcement, we may observe these kinds of shear failures. Okay, a failure due to shear is sudden. Okay, it is sudden. It is not giving any kind of warning or any time for the occupants to move outside. It is very sudden. So compared to a failure of flexure, if you compare it to a flexural failure, this failure occurs suddenly. Okay. The following five modes of failures due to shear are identified. First one is diagonal tension failure. Second is shear compression failure. Third is shear tension failure. Then web crushing failure and arch rip failure. Now I will show you all this type of failure with the help of a diagram. Okay, so the first you can see diagonal tension failure. So the occurrence of a mode of failure depends upon span to depth ratio, right? The same thing, span to depth ratio, the loading, which is a type of loading, it depends upon the type of loading, cross section of the beam, whether it is a rectangular section, I section, T section, L section, depending upon the type of section, then amount of anchorage and reinforcement. So this is general thing which is applicable for all the modes of failure, all the modes of failures. So the mode of failure depends upon which, upon these criteria, right? Span to depth ratio, loading, cross section of the beam, amount and anchorage of reinforcement. Okay, now the first kind of failure, diagonal tension failure. Okay, you can see that the beam is failing diagonally where it is failing near the support. Okay, it is failing near the support. You can see the cracks have started to propagate, right? And once the crack reaches your top face, this particular beam fails, right? In this mode, inclined crack propagates rapidly due to inadequate shear reinforcement. When you do not have proper shear reinforcement, which is required, your crack starts to form, right? You can see, and they are slightly bent, right? They are not straight, they are inclined, right? Inclined cracks start to propagate, right? You can see they have started to propagate, and these cracks propagate inclined in an inclined manner, and they reach the top surface, and you can see that it is failed, that your beam has failed, right? It is diagonal because your cracks are in an inclined manner, right? They are moving, propagating in an inclined manner, hence diagonal. And tension failure, because you can see that the steel has given away and your cracks have started to appear, and the beams your cracks start from your tension zone, right? Cracks have started from a tension zone going towards your compression zone. Okay, so this is a diagonal tension failure. Second type of failure is what? Shear compression failure. Okay, compression is there, hence there has to occur what? Crushing of concrete, because it is compression. So compression is mainly occurring in where? In your concrete. So crushing of concrete near compression flange. So this is your compression flange. This part is your compression flange. So near your compression flange, you can see there is crushing of concrete which is occurring. Crushing of concrete above the tip of the inclined crack. So you have an inclined crack which is propagating from your bottom towards your top, right? This is in inclined manner. So at the tip of this particular crack, you can see that there is compression of concrete which is occurring near the flange, near the top flange. Okay, so this mode of failure, which we have, what we call this kind of mode of failure, this is shear compression failure. Shear compression. Remember, these are not tension failures. All of these failures are in shear. Your beam, your element is sliding. Okay, there is sliding action which is occurring. That is nothing but shear, right? There is shear failure of this beam. Next, your shear tension failure, right? First thing was what? Shear compression failure. Similarly, we will be having shear tension failure. So tension will occur where? Tension will occur in your bottom portion, right? In your bottom portion where we have reinforcement. So when we do not provide enough anchorage to your longitudinal bars, right, when your bars are not properly anchored, and when there is no proper bond between your concrete and your steel, what happens? There will be slip of your bars, right? What that will cause is, it will cause diagonal cracks, right? It will cause diagonal cracks. You can see they are inclined, cracks are inclined, and they start from where? From the reinforcement, right? Where your steel has slipped. It will start and it will propagate in an inclined manner, right? It will propagate in the upward direction, right? Cracks propagate horizontally along the bars, right? They propagate along the bars horizontally first, and then it propagates upward in an inclined manner, and you will see that the beam will fail in shear, right? Your beam will fail in shear, right? In this fashion, it will fail. The beam will occur. There will be no tensile failure. There will be shear failure, okay? Remember, these modes of failures are for shear. Next, web crushing failure. Web crushing failure. So as the name suggests, the failure will occur in web, okay, by crushing. Crushing of what? Crushing will occur in concrete, right? Crushing will not occur in steel. Crushing will occur in concrete. So the concrete will crush where? It will crush in web zone. It will crush in your web. So web crushes due to inadequate web thickness. So when your web, right? So this is, suppose this is your I section and your web is very thin, right? The thickness of your web is very thin, which is in this case, you can see in this case, at the support, they have provided a thick web, right? At the support, the web is very thick. But here in this particular span, you can see that they have reduced the thickness. I hope you have seen this kind of elements wherein at the support, the element is thick, but as it goes on, right, it becomes thin, right? In the middle span, they make it thin. And again, at the support, this particular member will again become thick. Okay, so this is how the member is in your longitudinal view. I have shown you. So when your web is very thin, when your web is very thin, your crushing of concrete is occurring. You can see there is crushing of concrete in the web portion. So because of this, your web crushing failure will occur. So you can see there is sliding of your element, right? Sliding of your two planes, which is occurring because of this crushing of your concrete. So this is one more mode of failure, that is web crushing failure. Coming to next thing, that is arch rib failure. Arch rib failure, this usually occurs near your bearing. Okay, near your bearing, you can see where your support is. There, this kind of failure occurs. You can see there is a crack which is propagating, right? Cracks are propagating in this fashion for deep beams, right? For deep beams, which means when your depth of your beam is very high. Deep beams, the web may buckle. Web may start to buckle. It may start to bend and subsequently crush. You can see there is crushing of concrete which is occurring here also, which is occurring here and over here. So crushing of web is occurring right after your web buckles. There is subsequent crushing and there will be anchorage failure or failure of bearing, right? You can see that in this portion, you can see there is shear, right? There is shear of your member, right? You can see that this portion is sliding. This will slide upwards and this portion will slide downwards. There is shear failure at where? At your bearing. Because of what? Because your web buckling. Because of your web buckling, what will happen? Your concrete will crush in this portion. At here also, your concrete will start to crush and subsequently your beam will fail in shear. So these are various modes of shear failure which you have discussed, that is arch rib failure, web shear failure, shear in tension, shear in compression failure, and diagonal tension failure. So these are various modes of failure which you have discussed. Now, a few more things we are left out, that is this components of shear resistance. Okay, this is also very important. What are the various components of your shear resistance? So what we have done, we have taken a simply supported beam. We have taken a section of a simply supported beam. Okay, this is a section of a simply supported beam. This is what? This is your reinforcement, right? This is your reinforcement which is provided. Okay, your normal reinforcement which is running like this. Reinforcement. And this is what? This is your stirrup, which you can see in pink color. Stirrups which are provided. Okay, normally we provide stirrups in this format, right? So these are nothing but stirrups. Now what is this in green color? This is nothing but your tendon. This is your tendon which is running like this. Tendon which is provided. Okay, so these are all the elements, and we have taken a section like this. We have taken a section out of this particular beam. Okay. Okay, now this is your section which you have taken. So what are these various elements? I will tell you now what are these various elements. So you can see what is VCZ. VCZ is what? It is here. VCZ is here. So VCZ is shear carried by the uncracked concrete, right? Concrete does not crack here. Concrete cracks at the bottom portion, right? Where a tension is occurring. So when you consider an uncracked portion of your concrete, there will be some shear force which will be acting, right? Shear force. So this is nothing but VCZ, shear carried by the uncracked concrete. Now this is your this is your stirrup, right? Stirrup. So the shear carried by your stirrup is VS, shear force carried by your stirrup. We will name it as VS. Okay, now what is this VD? VD is the vertical component. Okay, vertical component of shear force in your reinforcement, right? In your longitudinal reinforcement, VD, which we call as, right? Why do we call it as D? Because it is acting like a dowel, right? It is acting like a dowel. So the shear resistance due to dowel action, right? Dowel action, VD. Next, VP. What is VP? This is your tendon, right? This is your tendon. Like this, it is going. The vertical component of this shear force acting in your tendon. Vertical component of the shear force acting in your tendon at this particular point. At this particular point, we will call it as VP. Okay, vertical component of pre-stressing force in inclined tendons. Vertical component of pre-stressing force in inclined tendons. Next, what is this VA? VA is what? Shear resistance due to aggregate interlock. Right, this is a concrete portion, right? This is your concrete portion, and we are considering the portion at the point over here. At this point, the shear force which is there in your concrete, okay, in your concrete or in your aggregate. Right, interlock, aggregate interlock. If your concrete has cracked, but your aggregate is still holding on, right? So because of that, there will be some shear resistance due to that interlock, right? Your interlock of your aggregate and your concrete, at that particular shear resistance, we will call it as V, okay, this particular vertical component. Okay, all these are vertical components. You can see VZ, VCZ is vertical. This is also vertical. This is also vertical. VP is also vertical component, and VD is also vertical. So all these forces we have resolved in vertical component. Even though if it is inclined, we will resolve it in vertical component, and we will consider. Okay, so all the vertical elements I have named. So these are the various components of your shear resistance. You have to just name, okay, just draw this diagram and you have to name this. Okay, we are not concerned regarding any derivation. You have to just remember, if they ask you to name the various components of shear resistance, you have to draw this diagram and you have to name all these particular elements. Okay, so I think with this we are done with today's session. Okay, so we have discussed the types of shear cracks, we have discussed various modes of failures, and we have discussed components of shear resistance, okay, along with a few basics of shear stresses, shear stress, how to derive shear stress, and various on how to arrive at our principal stresses, that is sigma 1 and sigma 2. We have seen how to derive this formula, and we have noted down the formula for sigma 1 and sigma 2. Those are nothing but principal stresses. Okay, so these are very important principal stresses, and regarding theory we have discussed, right? They will ask you to mention the types of cracks and the modes of failures, or they will ask you to write down the components of shear resistance along with a diagram. So this is theory part which we have dealt today, and in the next class we will start with the numericals, that is analysis of beams, right? Analysis of PSC beams in shear. Okay, we will be making use of your tau formula, tau VA Y bar by IB. So we will be making use of this formula, and we will be calculating your principal stresses in your next class. So this is regarding shear, okay, what we have discussed today. So I think we can end our session here. If you have any doubts, you can let me know. I hope you have understood. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Arthaitriya?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, so this is theory. You can read, you can understand. If you do not understand, okay, you can let me know. Okay, if you have any doubts. So I'll pass on these notes to you in your group. You can go through these notes in detail. Okay, then you can type in your attendance. Type in your attendance, please. I hope everyone has given their attendance. Give her attendance.